set an example. Set a viable example that's not based on like being the king.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? You just gotta be able to see the best person possible. You know, in charge. Niggas like Al Sharpton, niggas ain't, you know, in charge. That's all. So I'm saying, I mean, like, some real shit. Like, if I be our leader necessarily, that means this building, this house, it's a wrap. Because I'm gonna just have it, you know, like, culturally, like, you know, and put it under the guise of some clever shit so niggas don't have to pay for it. So, everything be taxed off, you know what I'm saying? And then, just have it there so people have alertness and whatever. I'm talking about like a room with a full of books, like a library dedicated to the tradition. Like I'm saying, any book that's written about the tradition should necessarily be that, have access to that information. You know, things start with teaching the dance and the drum class, and then eventually, as you grow up, support, make a daycare center. Because you then start with the seeds. Like, you start with babies, getting them from right now, programming them, and then you have to also program them to know that they have opposition against them. Like, that's one of the things that my mom didn't know necessarily, that they didn't drop the ball on, was giving me, you know, contrast. Like, yo, we're teaching you this, but the rest of the world ain't good with that. So this is how you gotta stash that so that you can, you know, you can perpetuate it further as opposed to letting it die out. And then somewhere along the lines, just as a young adult, you become despondent and you don't want to do it. So you rebel, but that's just a natural thing to rebel. But it gotta start with the babies. Like, if he can give me this building, it's cool. Because then ceremonies and anything that needs to be done can be done because you got space. You feel me? It ain't no building for now. Let's make fun to make a building, bigger building. But you understand, but you got something that's tangible. So that's my plan. Like, just start this cabildo. Take it back to the real old slaves like everybody put in, everybody come on. You know what I'm saying? I think it was Yusef telling me something about, you know, this chick that's working the bank and the Jews be coming in and the niggas to get, put their money together to get $1 million and put it in their bank account. Let that money swell up a little bit. Now you got all the credits and all of that, and you're taking advantage of that. They take that $1 million out your account and put it in his account. Now he gets the credits, and now he can start his business and take no money out of his shit, and vice versa. We have to have social economics. It's these two books. Sweepy, I just know Sweepy had. We should talk about, you know, the whole thing of a social. That shit is an African concept. Like, yo, we all put in a dollar. Today, it's 3 of us, I get $3. Tomorrow, you get $3. You know what I'm saying? But we always, everybody always has. As well as with the Cabildo, that shit is all about mutual aid society. Like I said, about buying your brothers out of bondage and shit like that. And establishing property, business, all of that. You have to have mutual, it has to be a collective. And we say we want to do that, but we haven't really done that. Because we allow, you know, religious dogma and shit like that to allow us to appoint another king. And then that motherfucker always, there's always ego, and there's always some shit that a motherfucker just throw shit out of whack because of his own insecurities. But when you got the council, which the whole thing in your book about that happened in the Ogboni society, even in the Native American culture in terms of council of elders, when you had that, when we're going, that's a true democracy. You feel me? Because they go to Black Dog to look at that motherfucker. It's a true democracy. We need to get back to that kind of stuff. So that, like, with the Cabildo, it's a based on, because I'm building the Cabildo based on my grandmother.
Right.
Nevertheless. You feel me? It's gonna be cool. The Cabildo Oruo Ba. You feel me? House of Congo. You feel me? Congo Abyssinia Brahma. And JJ the Toto Yambeki, like that's gonna be the whole, feel me? And then the patron deities for the Cabildo is gonna be Beiji. Because Beiji represents the children. And it's about the children, it's about the next generation all the time. Feel me? Because Beiji comes off as though they're children, but they in the temple. And the way that the Lucumi set Beiji up in terms of male, female, blue, red, it's a balance. It's that it's there yet and yet. You know, like people be like, they look for someplace else and say, oh, look what they did. Look what you got. The shit you got already has all of those things. You want to meditate, go get your head brocaded. You feel me? You want to meditate, sit in front of your bowl.
Yeah.
You want to do these things, but you get possessed. You got to, you know what I'm saying? Like, you have to set yourself to be in those environments. So, you know, it'd be a lot of fluff about shit that people don't really understand, like a lot of people are just talking about things that nuances that exist within Black American culture that are not acknowledged to being a part of African theology. You know what I'm saying? The spoon and the fork. Going to, back in the days, going to somebody's crib, right in the kitchen, they always had a spoon and a fork hanging from, you know what I'm saying, from the wall. That's some Yoruba shit. That's some shit about, you know, sustenance. That's the symbol that the women sororities were given in terms of the agricultural sororities and the guilds. See, that's the other thing that we don't have anymore, is guilds. See, like hip-hop, everybody, you know, the egotism of hip-hop didn't allow for guilds, but it was still trying to get to that. That's why you had all these crews. But you have to have a guild of people of the same skill. You know what I'm saying? Blacksmiths have a guild. They're all blacksmiths. MCs, it's one MC and a bunch of other niggas that don't rap. That's not conducive. You feel me? Nigga, you rap. You're supposed to be with other rappers. Put y'all in together. Let y'all come up with something else. So, it's like I said, you see these icons. Then, like I was saying before, the baby shower stuff. Go to the baby shower, they got a girl sitting in a chair, and it's a dawn, and they bring gifts, and they do all of these things, and they pin money and all of that. That's the shit they get out of the loop of me. If you ever go to a fundamental, when they playing for fundamental and they got
what's a fundamental?
A fundamental is like a sacred drum. When they playing a sacred drum, which means that drum is consecrated. It's not just a djembe or some drum, African drum. This is a drum that they're maintenance. You feel me? They're revered. They have their own shrine. Okay? When they have these fundamentals, they call them. These drummers are for really for priests. Like, everybody else is allowed to come and participate in the drum. But if you are not a priest, you're not allowed to actually function in the midst of it. So, what happens is, when they have what they call a horse, this priest that's going to get possessed, that's going to lay information for the deities.
Moms got old children. the first or third generation in this country. African American or whatever you want to call laws for all you people that need certain names and all that.
Well, even it goes even further than that. Like, one of my uncles did the genealogy. My grandfather's grandmother. Oh, yo. Huh. And the only record of a name they have is to call them mom. You know what I mean? She was the matriarch, but she was like a bed warm or some kind of thing. So she was her children, some of her children came out quote unquote black. You know what I mean? But our in terms of, because in Yoruba land, the twins are very big. Like, they're real big, especially in Oyo, because Shango stopped the infant side of twins, because they used to kill them, because they thought that was a bad omen. Shango necessarily introduced that into his religious practices, and that made it so that infant twins weren't killed. So, not to mention the fact that statistically, Yoruba land, Nigeria, it has the highest rate of twins in any place else in the world. And they attribute that to the meeting yam or something like that. Okay? That there's something in the yam that makes the cells, you know, split like that. So, because it's all relative, even in the worship of Shango, of a thunder deity, thunder lightning deity, the Yoruba have more lightning strikes than any place else on the planet. You understand? Again, how environment, you know, dictates your perception of God. So, for my grandmother to have a set of twins, you understand? It was instrumental in us, you know what I mean, being involved in these traditions. So my grandmother, because that title that she has, just biologically, is Iyaibe, mother of twins, which is a very big thing in Yoruba land. So her just doing that, so set a benchmark for the rest of us in terms of my grandmother being initiated before children, which is not the norm in this country. See, there are people, my grandmother is not one of the eldest people in these traditions, but my grandmother was involved in these traditions at least 10 to 12 years before she was initiated. And when she was initiated, like I said, she was initiated before her children. Like, nobody else had that luxury of their parents being made before them. So me being a third generation at the age of 34, about to be 35. Okay, and the traditions only been here. Something is close to 50 in the United States. So, you know what I'm saying? So my family is an anomaly just in itself. It's all my aunts and uncles got an ultra. You feel me? But again, going back to the thing about the cabildo, that's why I'm necessarily using Ibeji, because Ibeji, like I said, goes back to the children. You know what I mean? And with that's what we sow, is the children, you know what I mean? So we gotta necessarily come from that perspective, as well as it allows me to make it about the children. Because then in terms of festivals, it's always about the children. It doesn't become about the adults. You understand? And their shenanigans, it becomes about the children. You know what I mean? We're gonna have a celebration that's based on Ibeji, and it's gonna be the Ibeji party. So now you bring the children.
Right.
You understand it now? Just because even if none of them, one of the parents is not involved in the traditions, at least the child gets a chance to come interact with that. Later on, if he has an option about what kind of religious faith he has more reference as opposed to just Islam or Christianity. I mean, because Judaism is not even really, I wouldn't say it, but it's not usually an option for most black men, even though we have some Hebrews and whatever. But that's not an option, so usually it's just Islam and Christianity. But now if I give you another spin on it, I can give you another, at least you have a reference to it. The average black person now has no reference to these traditions other than in the perspective of witchcraft.
That's right. Yeah.
Of doing bad to somebody.
Right. It's always, oh, that's that voodoo. Right. That's that bad shit. You know what I mean?
Right.
Oh, y'all into that voodoo. Everything is voodoo. It's under one umbrella. Negative. You know what I'm saying?
Right. It's important that, you know, we necessarily, like I said, in terms of my viewers, have a cabildo, and I'm not trying to come and be nobody's savior. I'm not trying to be the next king. I'm not trying to, you know what I'm saying? I'm trying to necessarily set, re-fortify and reform the tradition for what it's worth. How does it function? How will it be able to function here in a modern society and still be indigenous? You understand? Because, and that's the thing. So, because people are now starting to try to expound, and they don't have the ethereal authority to do so. They don't have the ethereal authority or the esoteric authority to actually do that, to expound on it, because it's, they're converts. And that's why I always say that it won't be firm until 5 or 6 generations from now, when it's like, oh, my great-great-grandfather used to be a Lucumi.
So a bloodline as opposed to a convert makes a big difference when you're born, you're generationally born into it, as opposed to somebody that discovered it, however, at what point ever in their life, and now I'm a part of it. Now they want to call and make shots and all that.
It's in your DNA memory.
Right. Yeah.
The same
way. It's innate.
Exactly. And so that it becomes innate to live naturally.
Naturally. That's
because a mouse can see one mouse on a track. And when he sees that, he might never experience being on a trap, but he'll pass that on to his babies in the blood. That they'll see that trap and be like, I know what that is. I ain't walking on that.
Mm-hmm.
You catch 1 or 2 mice, after that you ain't catching no more. They hip to that shit, like, I ain't fucking with that shit. And they pass that on to their children, so that you got to come up with some new shit. It's the same thing. If you don't necessarily, like, it has to be, we have to cultivate that gene that's in us that allows us to be spiritual and be like that. We got to bring it back out. So we got to, and we have to cultivate that. And it's not until, like I said, generations that you have. Because the one thing that Islam and Christianity have on that they defeat the indigenous or the spiritual philosophies of the world is they have numbers. And when they have numbers, kinetically, psychic kinetic, that shit is crazy. Because you know that every day at a certain time, it's about at least no less than 1 million Muslims on their knees, praying in there. You understand? I said at least no less. No less. Yes, if you had that kind of mind power, you could move anything. You understand? So now, if everybody else was on it, that yo, the trees is important, the people, X, Y, and Z, not on some utopian kumbaya shit, but just in terms of general laws of the earth, and the weather wasn't good, consciously we can put our minds together and make the earth temper itself out. Because it's only reacting to the feel that we give off to it. You know, the Ghostbusters shit.
Mm-hmm.
And they're like, the psychic energy in the city is crazy, and it's allowing for the bad spirits to come out. That's the same thing. You feel me? It's the same thing. So now, you know, that's why, you know, and it goes into some other esoteric stuff, because, you know, stuff like Trayvon Martin and things like that, where these crackers are shooting black people. They're facilitating the sacrifice for what we see right now, being a footprint box for them to be able to walk around here like that. Feel me? That energy that created a crack era that allowed our neighborhoods to decompose, well, has been brought back by our blood. Feel me? And now they're reaping the benefits of it. You dig? The old blood that's been splattering these streets out here over these crack and gold chains and all that shit, that has necessarily tempered the energy, and now they're reaping the benefits of that. You feel me? They Trayvon Martin, all of that blood and shit, that's a subconscious consciousness that they all share. This is killing niggas and make us shed our blood on the 21. Because our blood is fertile, it brings life. Even if we're doing it to ourselves.
So just the fact that the blood is spilling, or the bloodletting is happening, from us killing each other or them killing us, that blood is the sacrifice.
Sure, it brings, like I said, the whole thing about the blood sacrifice, again, is the fact that you're taking something that is not tangible, that's a thought, it's an idea, and you're bringing it into the tangible world, and you're using the blood as the vehicle to do that. So the blood is flowing, it's a liquid. And now you kill it, and you put it on this icon, and now it dries. It just went through osmosis. It went from one form to another. And when it went from one form to another, the intention that you put in it, you made go comes from an idea to a reality.
Uh-huh.
So this is the same thing with our blood being shed on this concrete. The idea that they're going to have this utopia was fulfilled by our blood being the vehicle to stain the ground that they now walk on. And it's good for them.
Oh, dang.
You feel me? Because that's the purpose of the sacrifice. See, people get all wise, and it's not even to the sense. Because even on a ecological perspective, even if you're a vegetarian and you believe in all of that, at the same time, even in these traditions, we use herbal elixirs. Is that not the blood of the vegetation? Okay, so it's always that vehicle that allows for that osmosis, that transition from one reality to the other, because the realities are separated based on their makeup. You understand what I'm saying? So you can have seven things and you set them up in different configurations. If you put all seven of them together, sometimes you have the whole thing together. So we live in different realms of reality, and that blood is one of those things that allows for us to go from one reality exactly to the other.
Absolutely.
Light is one of those other, is another thing. That's why we worship light so much. A candle. You feel me? That's a very important thing. There was a time in human history. There was, you know, fire came directly out the sky. Let's be clear. Ain't no fire. All of a sudden, lightning strikes the tree. The tree's on fire. Somebody got hit to that and was like, yo, we need a piece of that fire. When they got that fire, that was a job for somebody in primitive man to maintain the fire. Because that became, you know, we changed from that. From eating flesh, raw flesh, which takes a long time to digest. Even for you, your son of, like, you being the son of Agayus. Agayus, the Risha that actually changed the course of man from going from eating flesh and living like an animal to living like a human being. Because he put the food over the fire. And when you put the food over the fire, then your body can digest it faster, and then you're not so sluggish, and then you can move around.
That's a hard one for the vegan mafia to process.
Like, yeah.
People think that black people, for some reason, these new age Negroes, think that we were always vegetarians.
Never.
You know what I mean? That vegetarianism has become the new cult.
Nah.
Or the new, you know, way for, you know, a lot of Negroes, you know, have, they out here thinking that, you know, you're just supposed to eat plants, eat raw, and I'm gonna make a raw pizza, and I'm gonna do, like, shit, it's outrageous. So for you to say that there was a deity, a god, Orisha, that actually taught man how to cook food, meat, flesh, lets us know that in ancient times, as always, man ate flesh.
Sure.
So don't get it twisted. African culture has always had flesh in their diet.
Well, that's what keeps us here. Is the sustenance of this reality. When the drummers come to do a sacred drumming, the first thing they do is they feed them. They don't feed nobody else. They feed them. They have their own table. They eat. And they eat. that they need food in their stomach so that they don't get possessed when they're playing that drum. Because they're about to do this, but they're about to open portals and chakras and all of that.
Mm-hmm.
So they have to eat so the food keeps them sustained. Now, the person who is slated to be possessed will do just the opposite. He'll actually fast. He won't eat anything because he wants to be pure so that he can be his connection to the ethereal will be easier because he won't be held down by the food which holds us down into this reality.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so you can necessarily not eat like what we said. I was hoping like even Phil talks about the fact that you don't necessarily need to eat to survive. Let's not get it twisted. Your cells don't consume and defecate. They don't do that. But in order for you to maintain in this reality, because it's a reality.
Physical, yeah.
But it's a reality.
Yeah.
So, and it is physical. So it being physical, you have to be physical to be in it.
Right.
So when you out of your mind, you're in a different reality. You're not in this reality. You're not in the physical reality. You're in another reality. You feel what I'm saying? So it's important for people to understand that there's certain meats and things of that nature that have certain amino acids that are integral to us. We need that. We need those proteins. Okay? Yeah, you can find them in a vegetable, but let's be clear. It is only in the advent of the modern society that people have had access to various different things. You know, when you go to the supermarket today, they got all this shit in there. But if you was in an indigenous environment, you would only have access to so many things because the other stuff is, you have to go get it. It don't grow in your area.
You have to eat within your body.
Absolutely.
If there's no kale salad for me in whatever part of the world I'm living in or environment I'm living in, I have to eat basically whatever the environment has.
Provides. Absolutely. Because what happens is everything that in the environment, and even like again, to quote Dr. Phil talked about that as well. Like it's real fact. Like you eat food that's imported from someplace else. That food is not picking up the natural auras of its environment. Like this tree gonna tell me about what's gonna happen around it if I eat the fruits of this tree. Okay? If I eat the fruit from someplace else, it ain't telling me nothing unless I'm coming near to conquer those people. Feel me? If I'm getting fruit from someplace else, it's to conquer those people.
Right.
If I know I'm eating this shit, I know what they up to.
Right.
You understand? So this idea that, you know, no, they didn't always have that. They had access to certain things and you had to obtain them by different means. Like, just how everything adapts, period. Just bottom line. Like, that's just human, not even human, it's just the nature of the universe. It adapts or it dies. Period. It ain't gonna do nothing else. It adapts or it dies. You're gonna find, if there's no water, you will find a place to find. Like, if there's no more rivers, you'll be up in the trees trying to find a little spots for the trees to catch the water to drink that shit. You will find a way to get what you need. You know what I mean? Because it's not just gonna be in one state. And especially in terms of how elements are in relationship to one another, the elements give birth to each other and so on and so forth. That you get, if you eat enough of that, you'll get the same results as whatever it is that you're looking for. You know what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
Like, the equation always goes like that. And I'm not saying it like literal, but let's just say vitamin E, 30 vitamin E's equal whatever it is that gives you to make it vitamin E. You understand? That is that kind of compensation that your environment provides for you. And if you don't, it's not available, then you don't need it. You don't need it because everything that the animals need to survive in extreme conditions, they have for them. They grow a coat, that shit is long enough to keep them warm. They keep that coat good because they eat this little bullshit grass or this little bullshit mesh. You feel me? They eat that and that shit builds it. enough fat for them, like they saw a lift. So there's this idea, like, that's that utopian idea, like, oh, yeah, new age shit, like, oh.
They're black people now.
You know, like, cause motherfuckers, what's that shit? I forgot, there was some shit, some berry that came out of South Africa, some fruit that everybody all of a sudden started eating, lose weight, and all kinds of shit. Like, that shit ain't natural to you. You don't want that shit in the world nowhere near. You know what I'm saying? Like, me being of African and Native American descent, I can't eat oranges. And for a long time, I didn't understand that, but that shit is not natural to here. That ain't natural to an African or Native American oranges. That shit comes from the Orient. Well, Chinese people brought oranges with them. Before that, what's no oranges in Florida? That shit don't grow there. You understand? You feel me? Like, so... And I'm allergic to it, so now I understand, because that's not natural to my, it's not conducive to my DNA. It's from someplace else, and wherever the hell, they in China, they need that vitamin C like that. You feel me? Mm-hmm. So everything that you need is provided for you, but we have to take into consideration that we live in the world is flat now. So because the world is flat, we interact with certain things, but we can't get fanatical about certain stuff. You know what I mean? Oh, I don't eat meat. That's cool. Like, and not to say that I'm not gonna necessarily curb my ways in terms of cleansing myself out, but I'm not about to get fanatical about it.
Everything has to be done in moderation.
Sure.
And everything has to be done for whatever time period it needs to be done.
And without judgment.
Absolutely.
See, now you get to be in the vegetarian, and now you go all against niggas that eat meat. Yeah. Like, fuck are you talking about? You was eating a burger before.
Yeah.
Like, that's good for you. Right, exactly. That's I know something better than
you.
Or I know more than you.
Yeah.
You understand? And we need to get off of that. Even if your brother is doing something that's destructive to himself, it's one of two things. He's either going to succumb to it or he ain't. What's the matter to him? You feel me? All I can do is give you the information. You gonna roll with me or not? I ain't gonna get upset. I'm not gonna stop fucking with you because you ain't doing what I'm doing.
Right.
You understand? Like, I got plenty of homeboys who are not involved in these traditions, and that's fine. I ain't freaking shove it down their throat.
You're judging me
at all.
Look down.
Yeah, I got a homeboy, one of my homeboys, I believe he belongs in the church. That should save his life.
Absolutely.
You feel me? Save his life a couple times. If he's gonna dedicate his life to Jesus, that's fine, man. I'm not mad at that. Okay? But don't tell me no what I do is some bullshit.
Yeah.
You feel me? Now you're out of control. What are you talking about? That shit works for you, then cool. You do that. You know what I'm saying? So, and what's happening is in these days and times, they're allowing the religious dogma to be attached to these traditions. And that's because of conversion. People are converted that come from that mentality, and they bring that fucking, in self-esteem and all of that transgression with them. They bring that shit with them, and then they attach it to this something. There is no dogma in these traditions. Europeans are the most adaptable motherfuckers you will ever meet. You hear me? They be like, oh, word, that shit, that worked on. If they put that shit in this shit, they act like this has been in fact.
Yeah.
I was reading the John Mason book, and me and my cousin was talking about it. He says some real shit, like, Europeans make everything, if they take any word and make it Europe, they'll break that shit down into their fucking, into their syllables, and they'll make that shit Europe. They'll make a reason that shit is Europe. Okay? Sure. Because they are so adaptable, there was the reason why out of majority of West African traditional indigenous traditions that they maintain. So they maintain themselves because they are not afraid to change. And that's because they're one of the deities is based on that. Or is based on change. You better change, motherfucker. You're gonna bend the brick. Feel me? So you might as well bend and get into that position, and wherever it is, you can stay like that. Until it moves again. You better be valuable. That's one of the things, even in terms of like what Oshun, when they associate Oshun with gold. Gold is a very good conductor, but it's not how you
feel me?
Oh, no, sure, it's that kind of thing. So maybe each one of the deities has a different alloy that's distributed into me. Now, Ogun represents the whole gambit of metals, but he gave each one to each deity. So, right, it's based on what they do. Like, you see, Oyashi has copper, well, copper. Oyashi is a lightning deity. Copper is a conductor for electricity. And it goes in water. Brass, crucial, it's also a conductor. You feel me? But it sustains itself in the water, fresh water. And Mayaz is associated to lead. Obatala is associated to lead. You understand that? That's not radioactive.